And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to this edition of the Robert Christian Show. It's a place where we get together and a time that we explore ideas and we toss ideas off of each other's mind, where we dig into the facts and we find the element of truth and justice. The Robert Christian Show is live every Friday at 3 p.m. Pacific Time. And visit us, of course, on the web at robertchristianshow.com. And as we do begin on today's live show, oh boy. Hey, folks, I do want to say that this is the last week that our dear friends, the kind folks at American Auctioneers, that they will be sponsoring the live show. This is the last show of the year for their sponsorship. But we would, of course, and as a note, say this, that the fine folks at American Auctioneers, they have launched their website for online bidding for storage auctions. If you like Storage Wars, you'll like their website. That's storageauctions.net. Visit them today and check them out. Great deals on storage auctions. You never know what is behind those doors. And whatever you do, don't forget to pay the lady. And also, not to be too out of whack, I had a great conversation with our co-sponsor for the live show. I missed them by a day, but anyway, I had a great conversation with them. But hey, if you all like freshly made cupcakes like I do, and I truly do. I mean, who doesn't, right? It's summertime. Our wonderful sponsors at Small Cakes at Renton Landing is the yummy place for you. Enjoy some of your favorite cupcakes and do try others. That is Small Cakes at the Renton Landing, the yummiest place on earth.
Robert Christian Show. Addressing issues that matter. Interviews and subjects beyond traditional news. Visit us online at www.robertchristianshow.com. And now, your host, Robert Christian.
And we are back. Thank you, Maestro and Mr. Announcer. Okay, let us dive into this, shall we? Folks, today's show is going to be something else because I am going to, and this is the first time in 37 years that I've done this, over 37 years. but this is the deal. I'm going to give you, everybody listening via podcast, we appreciate you. Do feel free to subscribe to our channel. And for those watching via YouTube, subscribe, as always, to our channel. And for folks on Facebook Live, we love you guys. You guys are the backbone of the show. And we absolutely, we adore everyone. Now, on this show, I am going to give everyone my solid prediction as to what is going to happen. Now, a year from today, I am going to make a note to go back and to re-listen to today's live show. And I hope that you do too. So will you join me in a year and listen to this live show all over again? In 1 year, 1 year's time. Okay. Because I'm going to give a prediction, and we are going to really put it to the test as to how far off base, perhaps, that Robert was. Or was he spot on target with his prediction? And it is going to be the prediction of who among them in the Democratic Party front runners that were at the debate in Miami, Florida last night and for the last two nights, which ones of them will actually end up leaving the race maybe a bit too early, but for whatever that the cause of it is or their reason is. And I have some names. Okay, first off, the first debate of the 2020 Democratic nomination fight is now in the books, with 10 candidates on stage and their answers being limited to 60 seconds, most of the candidates unwilling to engage in one another to debate. It was less than a debate than a series of multi-minute, one-minute speeches. Now, I watched the whole thing, and I picked out some of the best and some of the worst from the night that was. Now, during the first part of the debate, the central theme that was taken on was global warming, which many on the panel did not agree on a lot of things. The majority of them did agree that something needs to be done on the issue of global warming. A reminder from Jay Inslee, the governor from my state of Washington, however, was that the next president must address this issue of global warming or forever damage the earth and causing global warming to remain. We are now at the cusp of either changing the way that America and the world deals with recyclable goods versus goods that will harm the earth, the pollution in the water, the pollution in the air, to the ionosphere, and do what we can to curb it and to fix the problem. We as the human race have destroyed it. So he had a stark warning. And that's something that we should listen to. Now, first off, one of the big names in the debate was Joe Biden. Well, it really went poor for Joe from the get-go. Biden seemed to be rigidly attached to his stump speech and his talking points. If you notice, if you go back and you re-listen to him, he struggles to fit his points into the 60-second time limit, which anybody would. He got very defensive when Biden was asked if his first act as president, and he said that it would be to defeat Donald Trump. It was also said more than once that the greatest threat to America is, in fact, Donald Trump. More so than global warming, more so than perhaps a nuclear war somewhere, more so than America going to war with another country, more so than the global economy, but the greatest threat was Trump himself. Now, that was extended out by applause. Lines that Biden received where he mentioned Barack Obama. Everybody still loves Obama. But Obama is not on the ballot and he is not endorsing, at least at this point and not yet, Joe Biden. So it was very shaky for him. Now let's look at Bernie Sanders from the Sanders camp. Now the Vermont senator, he learned a very tough lesson last night, debating nine people, of whom one of the front runners for the nomination is a very different beast than debating a single establishment front runner when you are freewheeling insurgent here rather than being passionate. Bernie Sanders came off as just plain loud. And he did. All right. Now, this is my critique, right? So follow me along. Yang's online army insisted that the first debate would be his breakout moment, a chance to push his message for the dangers of automation to the general public. And he did do that. He also said that he believes that every American should be given a guaranteed wage of $1,000 a month, guaranteed wage, if you are 18 years of age or older. All right, that was his talking point. Let's look at Ms. Harris. The California senator gave the strongest performance, not just of Thursday night's debate, but of either side of that night's debate. She was calm, poised, and knowledgeable, and yes, presidential, she was. She had the biggest moment when she cut through a series of shouting voices, which is normal in this situation, and insisted America, the general public, they want to know how the candidates were going to put food on their table and not witness a food fight. And I applaud her for saying what she did. Now, she clearly has the line ready to go into the debate, but it doesn't change the fact that she delivered one of the most perfect time and without missing a beat. Now, Mayor Pete, now I'm bringing these names up, folks, and just follow me along, if you will. Follow me along, because it's all going to make sense when I give you my prediction. Mayor Pete, he's not the governor, Mayor Pete. And I do like him. He seems to be all right. Now, if you know anything about him, going into Thursday night, you would have assumed from his performance that, A, he was a senator or a governor who has been in this for a long time, and B, a co-front runner with Harris in the race. That person would be stunned to learn that that Mayor Pete is currently the mayor of South Bend, Indiana, running at the back of the lead of the pack. Yes, he is. He was serious, smart, thoughtful, and probing. Now, we're going to keep going. Now, we heard from all of the Democrats running that were on both platforms both nights. Now, we need to see early on which candidates reflect one or all of these 10 things. Now, if you are smart, you're going to reflect back on these 10 things and maybe even write them down. But at least for the moment's time, let's look at this. Because now you have a general idea. A general, right? Not really a good, firm idea, but you have a general idea as to these candidates and what they stand for. And what their main plank of their platform is. The main plank of the platform for the Democratic Party, it should not be, in quotation, to beat Trump. That should not be the plank of the platform. If that's what you're running on, if that is what any of these candidates are running on, is the plank to get rid of Donald Trump, to get him unseated out of the White House, then what are you going to do for the next 4 years after that you took the office. What are some of those things? So it's a no-brainer to say that that's not a solid plank in a platform. Here's 10 things that we need to pay attention to. First, we need to find out which one, and by listening to our gut intuition, by listening to them speak, doing our research, going online, you can do that. You've got one of the best dictionaries and one of the best research tools ever invented for the human race right in front of you, or in the palm of your hand. It's amazing. So, number one, who is the best hope for the party? Now, that's important. Is the best hope for our party, for the Democratic Party, is it Joe Biden? Is the best hope for the party Harris, or who? Who is it? So we need to be looking at a good before and after picture of this. Number two, the strongest to take the White House. You see, we do need a strong man, a strong woman, to take the reins of the White House, and someone who is so willing and will be diligent to reverse the things that have been done in the last 2.5 years that have damaged our economy, that have damaged America's credit rating, that has damaged America on the political front worldwide. We need to have someone in there that absolutely has ideas, that is going to uplift the American worker, not the American multi-billionaires or multi-millionaires, but the average American Joe. We need to have somebody that can speak the language for America. And you see, I will say, 4 years ago, or well, not quite that long, well, maybe 4 years ago, when Joe Biden, not Biden, but Bernie Sanders, when he was running, the thing of it is that Bernie Sanders, back then in the last election, he spoke the language that the American people needed to hear. Now, I think that what really sold him down the river was one point. And you can't run a successful presidential campaign on one point without having counterpoints. And he ran on one. And that run, that one point was Medicare for all. Now, is that a good idea? Perhaps it is. Would that end up costing people their health care? No, absolutely not. So why would you want to pay for something if through a private insurer, if you get or would get free health care through Medicare for all type plan and program? Now, also on the ticket here as a plank in this platform, some, not all, of the candidates believed that the college tuition should be forgiven. And people should be given the right to go to a local community college free of charge. And to that, I salute them. Do you have any idea how much that the student debt is in America today? It's over $1.5 trillion. If you file for bankruptcy, you can't write off or have forgiven student loan debt. And that is absolutely insane. So surely when people graduate out of college, they're going to have $300,000 or $400,000 in debt. You could own a house for that. The interest rates are up and up and up and up. Nothing has been done about the interest rates. The interest rates are not flatlined. And it's ridiculous. They absolutely should be. Well, I think that America and our country as a whole should get out of student loan debt. Now I'm talking as if I were running. All right. The strongest to take the White House. Number three, leadership abilities. Who among them that were standing before America for the last two nights, who among them has leadership abilities? Now, I'm not saying that any of them, like Trump, would go and say, oh, look how well that I'm doing. I mean, I must be doing things great because look at Wall Street. Let's look at the stocks and bonds and the trading. Let's look at all this. It's great. Let's look everywhere else. But don't look at me. It's everybody else's fault if something's going haywire. Oh, but it's my fault. It's my doing, right? If something good is happening. Oh, look at Wall Street. Oh, it's in record profit. You see, you can't look at Wall Street as a political temperature check as to how well that you would be doing as the president. A leader of America and a leader in the free world is not someone that says, I can do it alone. I can do it alone. It's not somebody who brags their way to leadership or brags their way into the White House or lies their way into the White House or divides America while in the White House. That's not a leader. That's an idiot. And we see this. But we need to have solid leadership. Someone with a proven track record. All right, let's continue, shall we, please? Might be interesting. Number four, willing to change the entire political climate in America. Look at where America has gone in the last 2.5 years. Hate crimes are up everywhere. Now it's suddenly okay. It's now suddenly acceptable to hate, to cause judgment on others, to bash others because they are gay, lesbian, bi, straight, whatever that it is, because they are black or white. It's okay to hate these people no matter what. I mean, there now are laws on the book that gives them the license to do so. Is that the political climate that we need in America? If you say no, you're right. America is better than this, and I've always said that. And I'll stick by that target. The political climate in America, it is absolutely in shambles. Look at how many people are homeless on the street now, and that 2.5 years ago they weren't. Look at the income inequality in America. That's a big one. That's another Bernie Sanders talking point, which I agree with. Something does need to be done. The $15 an hour minimum wage federally, that's okay. I can deal. But realistically, it should be something more like $20 or $25 an hour just for people to make it. Folks, this is America. And in my frame of mind, not one American should have to work a 40-hour job, full-time employment, times three, just to keep a roof over their head and food on their table. So the unemployment rate, it may be doing all right, at least temporarily. The tax breaks for the ultra wealthy, that's ongoing. But is that a positive political climate in America? Or is that really ushering in an ultimate destruction, bringing us back into something very similar to the Great Depression? We really need to pause and think about it. Number five, this is a big one. Who can unite America? Which one of the candidates? Now, if you are Democratic, And if you are already sold to the idea that I'm going to vote Democratic, there's no way I'm going to vote Republican, all right, then who among them? Now, it's early in the game, yes. Way early. Well, it's early. But these are still some very hot ticket issues that right now is when we need to face them. Right now is when we need to look at these. So from this point forward, we're like, I heard that before. Now it makes sense. Now I can understand this. So number five, who can unite America and bring us as a nation forward into a vibrant future? Are any of those candidates capable of doing this? You got to remember that there is a lot at stake when you're talking about the disarray of America. There's a lot going on, and we need to be well versed in it. Now, the food fight that we saw last night, or the near food fight, that was normal because the candidates were trying to find where they fit, and they were trying to find, by applause, by social media gathering places, by news articles that would be posted today, how well that they did or how well they didn't do. So I can understand why they did that. But there are more debates around the corner. And those ones are ones that they themselves are going to have to focus on and have to be prepared for. So among these that were in the Democratic debate, which one of them or ones do you think can unite America? Right now, America is so divided. It is absolutely sad. Number six, who can speak for America and entrusted to hold the office as sacred? The office of the presidency is very sacred. The Oval Office, historic, yet it is a very sacred and very solemn place. Who can speak for and stand up for America? In other words, not somebody that is going to sell secrets, give secrets away, make trade deals that do nothing but benefit the wealthy. All right, am I getting somewhere? Are you guys getting this? Somebody in the White House that can speak America's language. Easy to understand, easy to comprehend. Someone that has America's back. Truly. And yet someone who could be entrusted with the most sacred office of the land. We'll be right back. With your kind donation to the Robert Christian Show, it will help us to reach our goals in providing content that you love. RobertChristianShow.com/donate. With interactive newsmakers and interviews, your progressive voice, The Robert Christian Show. And we are back, ladies and gentlemen, with the live Robert Christian Show. And happy Friday, everyone. If you are new to the Robert Christian Show, hey, we do welcome you. And we are grateful that you are tuned in. So, hey, do a favor and let your friends, your neighbors know about the show, about the podcast, about the live shows, the YouTube channel, everything. Let them know about it so people can either get mad with you, get angry with you, not at you, and or it can raise maybe awareness as to some of the issues that we truly do face in America. So cheers, Governor. All right. Number 8. And then we're going to go to 10, and then I'm going to give you my prediction. And maybe why. Number 8. Who can stay focused? Now, this is a big one. Who can stay focused and on point? You see, in the last presidential election cycle, 2.5 years ago, you see, the big thing was, and if you go back, I mean, the videos are plentiful, where one of those candidates on the Republican side made a point, and he said, well, I've given to everybody's campaign. Pat me on the back, someone, quick. I'm the one who gave to everybody's campaign, even when they weren't popular. I did it, and oh, that's great. And then suddenly, here came the pet peeve names, the Lion Ted, the Sleepy Joe. Come on, the Crazy Bernie. Yeah, I mean, we all heard this, right? 2.5 years ago. All right. Having said that, and looking back at that, it was one man who was center stage always and always promoted himself rather than promoting the platform that he stood on. But you can look at Asia, you can look at China, you can look at America, you can look at the Clintons. Oh, they were bad people, bad hombres on both sides, real bad people, right? Whatever happened, it didn't happen. There are no pee-pee tapes, right? We come on. No collusion, no obstruction, no collusion, on and on and on, right? And even to this day, this same person, this same figurehead, when asked a question, a straightforward question, his response always is, well, look at this, and oh, look at that, and look at something else. Is everybody else's fault? Unless it's good, then it's mine. It's my doing. Pat me on the back. Right? But otherwise, he always says, look at this, look at this, look at the other thing, and look at something else. That first is not staying focused, nor is it on point. So I, for the last 2.5 years, I have not been one to congratulate every little thing that Donald Trump has said or done. I haven't. Now, when he has done things that have been worthwhile and good and positive, I've definitely spoke those words. When Barack Obama was president, even with him, there were things about him that I did not agree with. And if anybody was listening to the live shows back then, you know what? I was just the same then as I am today. One of the things that I did not necessarily agree with was the mandate on Obamacare. But I think that Obamacare did not go far enough because it did not rein in the price of prescription drugs, nor did it reevaluate the entire system and be constructive to lower the actual cost of prescription drugs and hospital visits, all this stuff, for the American people. It did not do it. And it should have. It could have. So easy. but it wasn't addressed. So which of the Democratic candidates to you stayed focused and on point? Very timely, very interesting. Number nine. Now, this is something that we saw in the last election 2.5 years ago. And we saw a lot of it on the Republican side. On the Democratic side, to a point. But it's this. Are you guys ready for this? Who among them can hold their tempers back? When someone is called out for bad behavior, called out for bad policy or a bad idea, how many of these and who within these 10 can hold their temper back? And rather than saying it's my way or the highway, rather than saying, it's somebody else's fault, someone who can say, wait a second, maybe there's something that I should learn. Maybe I missed the point. Maybe I misspoke. This is what I meant, or this is what I should have said. Someone who can look before America in the event of a crisis and be solely and solemnly apologetic for bad behavior that perhaps it would come out of the White House. We don't have that kind of a leader today. Someone that would be stepping foot into the White House, taking the oath of office, should be able to hold their temper back. And rather than saying, look at what I can do it all by myself. Look at all the good that I am doing. Oh, praise be to me. No, they should be saying, look at America and look at how well that America is doing. Let's move forward, folks. This is important. It's absolutely vital. So if the viewers of the live shows and those that are listening via podcast, look, you could forget me. You could forget my name. That's okay. But I hope that you don't forget the message that I'm bringing to you right now. Because in the future, we are going to look back at these 10 items. One way or another, every American will. And we're going to look at these. And we're going to say, you know what, maybe I should have paid attention to this. Or maybe I did. The outcome was horrible, though. Or we will sit back with great pride and say that the outcome of what the election was splendid. We finally have somebody in office that can hold their tongue and hold their tempers back. Keep them in check and be the leader that America needs. Number 10. We need to find out if they can and are willing. Wow. To uphold the Constitution while understanding the complete balance of power. Understanding that it is not just the executive branch that has the control over America and the world, for that matter. But the three equal branches of government. Someone in the White House that understands the Constitution. Someone who understands the First Amendment right, the Second Amendment right, the Third Amendment, the Fifth, the 25th. Someone who will uphold the Constitution as a rule of law and as a rule of morals. You see, we have seen the complete opposite in this. With who is in there today, the complete opposite. Someone who refutes the Constitution, someone who has claimed that the Constitution is not fair to him. And now Lindsey Graham saying, oh, wouldn't it be great if Donald Trump ran for three consecutive appointments as the president? Three terms, which is against the Constitution. Is he getting backlash for the statement? You bet he is. But we need to find out if they can uphold the Constitution. Now, part of this, and I know that this is going to be coming down the pike for some folks in their mind, and that's this. Will the new president see to it that Donald Trump is held liable for any and all crimes that he potentially has committed while in office if Congress and if the U.S. Senate do not? That's really a dangerous area, or a very gray area. I'll say that, a very gray area, because that hasn't happened before. And you see, this is where one of the candidates focused a lot on what was in the previous administration, some of the fantastic things that happened, focusing on those and reeling in the satisfaction, I guess, of seeing that at least some of it was still intact, rather than looking ahead at where we can pick up and where we can go from here. But accepting and acknowledging the complete balances of power are very interesting, but yet very vital. So there is your 10 points. The best hope for the party, the best hope of winning, not necessarily defeating Trump. Two, the strongest likely to take on the White House. Three, leadership abilities. Four, willing to change the entire political climate in America from what it is, for what it's become. Number five, who can unite America? Great point. Six, who can speak to and for America, entrusted to hold the office of the presidency sacred? Seven, who can lead America into its future? A vibrant future. Is America going to be stuck in the 1940s? Or are we going to be moving forward and say to America, to the world, yes, we can do this together. We can combat climate change. We can combat disease. We can combat all of these things together. Or are we going to have someone in there that can say, oh, don't worry about it, I and I alone can fix it? Who can stay focused and on point? Number nine, who can hold their temper back? And 10, find out if they can uphold the Constitution while understanding the complete balance of power of all three branches of government. Now, I said all of that. Let me take a drink. I said all of that to say this. Here is my prediction. I think that based on what that I have seen in the first two presidential debates for the Democratic Party, Michael Bennett will most likely drop out. He may not be speaking the right language, the right body language, the right style, the right enthusiasm. to the heart of America. He may not. Now, it could surprise me, and it would surprise me if he stayed in. And it would surprise me if he, with great anticipation for something far bigger than he is, was on his mind, and he spoke those articles. He spoke those oracles. He spoke those fundamental beliefs to America, to the heartbeat of America. Then perhaps, but so far I didn't see that happen. Maureen Williamson, I think that she will end up dropping out, although that she is brilliant in her ideas at her first debate. It was shy of whatever that her goal needed to be. So I don't think that she's going to make it. Unfortunately, I'm calling it the way I see it, and I don't. Andrew Yang, I think that he will also end up dropping out. His idea of giving every American $1,000 a month guaranteed income seems to be his top priority. It's not necessarily a bad priority, but a top priority. I think there's a little problem. He also seemed, I mean, who wouldn't want $1,000more a month if you're 18 years of age or older? Who wouldn't as a guaranteed income? I would rather see that than the billionaires walking away with $1.5 trillion in the first 10 years of a tax break. I would. But he also seems to want to jumpstart our economy from the bottom up, which is good. I don't think, though, that it's going to be well received. The wealthy are not going to really like that. The wealthy want to keep the poor poor. Those who have millions of dollars, those who own their businesses, those who are doing well, they don't want to see the poor do too well or become too comfortable. They just don't. They'd rather lavish those things upon themselves. And, well, that's kind of the way it is. Eric Swalwell, I think he'll also end up dropping. Jay Inslee, now he is my governor, the state of Washington, and I like him, but not to a fault. But I think that he will end up dropping out, basing his campaign upon global warming alone. That was the number one platform, the number one plank in that platform that everyone that we saw two nights ago. So I think that he will end up dropping out, because when he is focusing his energy, his attention on global warming alone as a political platform, that alone and solely, singularly, is a very bad move. That's an idea. Yes, we need to address it, but you can't run an entire campaign based on that. You'll never win. But it seems to be his top choice talking point. Otherwise, a bit shallow in where that he should be excelling. Maybe he will begin to excel in these areas. Maybe. I also predict that Ms. Harris, Castro, Biden, and Sanders will remain. However, I don't see Bernie Sanders winning, but I think that he will stoke up the Democratic base. Now, I don't know so much that is going to be a good thing for the Democratic base to have Bernie in there again. or not. You know, during the last election, I think that he did speak what America needed to hear. But today, I don't know so much that he is speaking the things that America needs to hear. But a lot of what I had heard was a washback, right, from the last presidential campaign and some of his hot ticket points then, and trying to use those again now. That is a big problem. Joe Biden. Oh, boy. Okay, Joe. Now, I do like Joe Biden. Is he electable or not? We will find out. But he needs to base his ideas, his platform. And I hope if Joe is listening to this podcast, if he does, first, hello. But I would tell him this, and to his face I'd tell him, that he needs to stop basing his ideas, his present ideas, on the past administration and their successes. But he needs to focus his ideas and base his ideas and own these ideas as his own for 2020. It's a new generation coming to the White House. And this is something that absolutely we need to focus on. I mean, again, I like Bernie, Joe Biden. I like Bernie too. But Joe Biden, he needs to not focus on what was, but on what is. America was a fantastic, vibrant place back when he was the sitting vice president. America was doing well. Surely, it could have done better. There were things that could have happened that just didn't. And to this day, I still have problems with it, like a majority of Americans. But it will obviously and apparently go down in history that administration was one of the best administrations in our present lifetime. So Biden needs to gear up his own base with his own ideas and focus on the future and not necessarily be solely looking back at what happened and the successes or maybe even the failures of the prior administration. Now also look at Kamala Harris. Thus far, she's proven to be solid and wide range scope being used. Now she is definitely one to watch. Castro, although I do not believe that he will win, he will, however, change the Democratic platform if you listen to him. We need to focus, and of any time in America and in our history, we need to be looking at this. Robert Way, hey Robert, saying Bernie or bullets. Well, I mean, again, I think that Bernie, he has a lot of very interesting ideas. He does. But I want to hear more of Bernie and a little bit less on the one pivotal issue that he does bring up, and that is Medicare for all. Surely we know that we in America, we do need health care. And a wide range of healthcare that is affordable. But you know what? Speaking of which, because Congress and the U.S. Senate, they passed a law that forbids the government from negotiating cheaper prices for prescription medication. Did you know that? Thus, whatever that the pharmaceutical companies choose to charge, the government, if you are on Medicare or Medicaid, if you are on Blue Cross or Blue Shield, they themselves cannot lobby these giant pharmaceutical companies for cheaper prescription drug prices. That is simply illegal. And I want to get into that. Maybe on a future show I will. Because, folks, you know what? I look at what's happening. The political climate, it is absolutely horrible. Something does need to change, and it can. But a last note to you is this. We the people still reserve and have and hold the power. One of the greatest powers that we could possibly ever have. The power to vote, the right to vote for the candidate that we choose. That is one of the most powerful things of any country on this earth. And for our right to vote, the weight of that vote, it must count. It really must. I want your vote to count, and I want your ideas to count. So when I was going through the preparation of today's live show, I wanted to speak to the heart of every American. Look, the real problem, the sacrificial problem, right, that we're seeing right now in Congress, the U.S. Senate, and the White House, it's baiting, because you are demeaning one party to legitimize another. We've got to stop doing that. What we do need to do is to start looking at the issues that we all face, call them what they are, as American problems. America, in each and every one of us, we can fix this. And we can do so at the ballot box. I was happy to hear that some of the candidates said that one of the greatest threats to America, it is, who is in the White House today. Folks, it is time that we change that perimeter. We can do this. Folks, I'm Robert Christian. This has been the Robert Christian Show. Visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. And we would, of course, encourage you and ask you to help to donate to keep the show live and going. There is a lot at stake, and this is not the time for progressive voices not to be heard. You like progressive news talk, and you like a challenge, a good weekly challenge on every single show. Well, this is the place, really, to help to support it. If it's $5, $10, $20 or more, it helps us to attain what we need to do and for us to continue to go forward with the live shows in its future. It's important. So, having said that, folks, I will be taking the next 2 weeks off downtime. Not vacation, I'm not going anywhere. But I just will not be doing live shows for the next 2 weeks. So I need time, R&R, time away from things. And when I come back, oh boy, we've got some fantastic changes and fantastic things that are just around the horizon. Folks, I'm Robert Christian. We'll see you next time.